spring brought Fred another boon. A £4,500 contract that would keep his family and leave a margin for further work on his engine.
This particular job is sort of a bit upsetting to me because it's like the last spinning mill in Bolton with a proper chimney. You know, and I'm going to wreck it. All that beautiful fancy work round the top. I've got to take all of that off and lower it down to the ground, you see. And this isn't quite as simple as just knocking bricks off top of a chimney. Here, there's no room at all, you know, and I've got to lower it all down in buckets, about 100 weight at once, you see. You know, I'd very much like to mend it and make it, you know, glorious again for another long period, but really, it's redundant. Nobody loves it no more. Nobody wants it anymore, and they've no bloody use for it because, you know, they've only got a toy boiler down at the bottom. You know, when I first started climbing chimneys, there were quite a lot of places on coal. I even had the great pleasure of working on one or two where they actually still shoveled it on by hand and all the black foul smoke used to come out. But that stuff, you know, it used to come out at top and all the gutters in the immediate neighbourhood and all the year's lace curtains rotted away. But this blue stuff from the oil makes you cough and splutter worse than Capstan Full Strength. It's a bit like putting your mouth around somebody's exhaust pipe, you know, up there, like, not very nice. In the other epic thing we did about climbing chimneys, you know, I was criticised for saying, you know, I had a few pints before I climbed up. But, you know, I'd like to say that, sort of, you want to try this bloody job sober, you know. Yeah, if I've had a couple of pints of beer, you know, I don't, you know, think I'm King Kong-like sort of thing. You know, take it that little bit easier, you know, and more cautious. The thing is that once you've got up that first bloody ladder, you've only got to make one wrong move and you're dead. You know, I mean, them boards, there's great gaps in them, you know. I mean, you could put one foot through a space and not even fall off, but smash your bloody leg in two pieces and then you'd feel a bit of a fool. Well, fire brigade's no good because the ladder's not long enough. Somebody would have to come and rescue you with an helicopter, you know, which is a bit of a, look, you know, we can't have any of that, can we? Well, when you've had a pint or two and you're stuck up on top of a big factory chimney and sort of the calls of nature become imminent, you can either have a go down the middle or over the edge, you know, whereby they think it's raining in the next field. One instance that comes to mind where we had this bucket full of cement water and kept having a go in this. And then at the end of the day, we decided to throw it off, like, you know, pitch it out, like, over the side of the ship, you see. There's a bloke at the bottom with a magnificent bright red Alfa Romeo sports car. And when we came down, it was summertime, and all these beautiful red motor cars were covered with white cement urinated spots. Funny, you know, all over it, drying very well in the sun, you see. This contraption I sort of invented myself purely through watching the steeplejacks of like 1940 and 50. One famous firm from Manchester would arrive and just commandeer a skip out the mill and put four ropes, one on each corner, and like they'd literally pull the damn thing up by hand and put as many bricks in as they thought were sort of necessary and then lower it down, you know. And then I saw an improvement on that two milk churns on a similar sort of setup that we've got here. But it's still got to lower the one down, sort of just let it come down at 2 mile an hour, which it like took 5 minutes for the bloody thing to get from the top to the bottom. And one day it dawned on me that if you had a brake drum on the haulage system somewhere, you could like control the thing yourself. Mind the brakes on all the time. And when the can's full of bricks, which amounts to about 100 weight, I just lift up the lever and down it goes, and the empty and comes up, you see. And then Donald down at bottom knocks the catch and out come the bricks, and as long as we can keep it going all day, like, we're in business. Up here you get sort of rather ideas of grandeur, you know, you're sort of looking down on all these humble rows of little houses and sort of, you know, it makes me glad that, you know, I'm up here and not having to open my front door and go inside this bloody place, you know, instead of being free like a bird. Like, I often think that, you know, my sort of lot or life is, you know, it's more exciting and varied than most people's. You know, they never, you know, sort of have anything exciting, you know, unless they're having a bloody strike or something, you know, sort of. Like, steeplejacking, that's one thing that, you know, that appealed to me, because I think basically I'm lazy, you know, like, sort of a job where some days when it rains, I'm quite happy because I can go home and do something on my engine, you see. Whereas if I were tied to a machine in a factory or an office, you know, you'd be, you know, like watching the bloody clock all day. People say, are you not bored knocking all them bricks off? And, well, the answer is, like, no, really, because the job's so reasonably simple that You can sort of carry on doing it, and you've part of your mind's conscious for the safety part of it, and the other part you can let wander away to more pleasant things, you know, like mending steam engines.